what are called responsive web pages. We talked about two things that we can do last week. And they are, first of all, using floating instead of fixed layouts. In other words, when you use absolute positioning and you put things in a certain place on the page, then the content doesn't conform to the size of the screen. The content gets fixed. So whether you have a wide window or a small window, things are going to be positioned or nailed down in those certain positions. And that's not good when you talk about trying to make responsive sites. That is, sites that respond to the device on which they're being displayed. So that on a smaller device they look one way, on a larger device they look another way. And that's actually our goal, right? Because there's a high percentage of people, and again, you hear different statistics, but a high percentage of people do more surfing actually on their phone than they do from a desktop browser. A lot of people do, and that number is only increasing, all right? So having a website that works both on a mobile device and on a desktop device is definitely a high priority. All right, the second thing we talked about is using percentages instead of fixed numbers. So we even saw how we could make an image a percentage of the screen so that it could take up 100% of the available space. So as the window got smaller, the image got smaller. And that helps with mobile devices as well. The last thing we're going to talk about is what's called media queries. Now, media queries are where we can take and we can apply style sheets when the page is being displayed on certain kinds of devices and apply different style sheets when a page is being displayed on other devices. All right? So let's show an example of that. And again, this is just meant to be a simple example. But let's show an example of that, and then we'll talk about it more in detail. I'm going to open this up in the Chrome browser, because the Google Chrome browser allows the ability to display a page and to simulate different devices. So here's what the page looks like on a normal device. On a desktop device. Whoa. And notice that the image is done with a percentage. So this follows the rules that we had before. Now, one thing that's good with the Google Chrome browser is I can go into under Developers Tools. And I actually can simulate different devices. Like, how would this look on a laptop? How would this look on a laptop with a touch screen? And so on. So notice when I change it to the Google Nexus 4, the page looks totally different. All right? The page is simpler, for one thing. In other words, it doesn't have the image at all. All right? It doesn't have the background image, the wallpaper sort of behind it. And instead of being laid out in multiple columns, it's laid out just in one column. All right? So these are all things that we want to do typically when we're displaying something on a mobile device versus a desktop. In a nutshell, we want to make everything simpler. All right? We want to make everything simpler for a couple reasons. First of all, the hardware is bound to be less powerful. The internet connection is liable to be slower. The screen is physically going to be smaller. And for all these reasons, in general, we want to make the design simpler. So here's a case where we have two different pages. And again, depending on how it's being viewed, it'll look one way if viewed, for example, on a laptop. It will look another way if viewed on a phone. All right, let's take a look and see how we accomplish that. Let's open up the code. Oops. And the first thing you notice, well, I don't know if it's the first thing you notice, but it's the first thing I'm going to point out to you, is there's actually a couple different style sheets. First, you know, we have these things that we talked about before. Remember, this is a code that I won't say makes the page HTML5 compatible or makes the browser HTML5 compatible, but helps a little bit. It assists older web browsers in being able to understand HTML5 code. So those don't really count in our discussion here. Those are needed, but they're not really what's relevant to today's discussion. What's relevant to today's discussion is this. We actually have two style sheets. All right? Can you have two style sheets? Well, we must be able to have two style sheets, right? No one has rushed into the room and arrested me or anything, so it must be legal to have two style sheets. How does it work when you have two style sheets? Well, when you have two style sheets that apply, they sort of go in order. In other words, you get this style sheet, and then if anything in this style sheet overrules something in this style sheet, this is the one that applies. Okay? So it just goes in order. So the first style sheet applies certain characteristics, like maybe the width of columns, the background color, the text color, the font, and so on. The second one then is going to overrule the first one for some of the elements. But, and that might sound weird, like, well, why would you want to do that? Well, it only does it under certain circumstances. It only does it if you're talking about a screen and not a mobile device, and the width of the screen, the minimum width of the screen, is at least 601 pixels. So in other words, it's going to do this for bigger screens, for laptops, for desktops, and unfortunately maybe even some larger phones. But again, for the smaller screens, this style sheet isn't going to apply. So in other words, every device gets this style sheet. Some devices get this style sheet. And some of these devices, the rules that are defined in this style sheet get overruled by the rules in this style sheet. Which devices get it? That's what the media query is. We specify the conditions by which, hey, these are the guys, these are the devices that get this. And in this case, only screen. Screen means a computer screen. If it's a mobile device, it will say handheld there. That's the terminology used for that. Unfortunately, some mobile devices identify themselves as being screens and not a handheld. So we have part two that says, and the minimum width is at least, the screen is at least 601 pixels wide. All right? So that's why if we look at this page, using a Google Nexus 7, it looks like this. Because this is not a computer screen. It's simulating a phone. All right? And therefore, the second style sheet doesn't apply. So let's look at these two style sheets. Here's our base style sheet. This is what everyone gets, unless the second style sheet overrules it. The body, font family Helvetica, Arial, Sans Serif. Header, width 100%, border 1 pixel solid red. navigation width 100%, border 1 pixel solid red, nav li, display inline, nav ul, list style type none, section width 100%, border 1 pixel solid yellow, section image, display none. I don't know if you noticed or not, but when we view this page in the mobile device, there's no picture. If, however, we view it, and I'll open it up in Internet Explorer, if we view it on a computer screen, there is a picture there. So how do we make that happen? Well, if we look at the HTML here, I think I have it open, yeah. I specify that any image within a section in the base style sheet has a display of none. That means we simply don't show it. All right? We've seen before using display of block and display in, of inline, and then display of inline block. Another display type is none, which means that you cannot show that image on a mobile device. So again, think about if you had a page that had a dozen different links on it. And remember we said before that on a mobile version of the web page, typically people don't want to do everything that they do on the full web page. So maybe we want to hide some of the links and not make them visible. We could do that. Any content that we don't think is necessary, that we don't want to display on the mobile version, we can put in the style sheet, display none, and it won't show it. All right. We could then do something that says, hey, if you really want to see the full site, click here, and we could write some JavaScript code to show that code or whatever, but that's a problem for another day. All right. The bottom line is we can go and we can cut off content just by saying display none. Now, remember that everyone gets this style sheet. Notice there's no media query here. It's a style sheet. This style sheet applies to every device viewing this page. The second style sheet only applies to computer screens and larger phone screens. So if I go and edit that desktop style sheet, we'll notice the changes. So we don't have to repeat everything in that second style sheet. We just put in the things that we want to change. So for example, on a mobile device, we use Helvetica Arial Sans Serif. When we view the same page on a desktop device, notice that we're using a serif font. So one of the things that we have in here in the desktop is we make the body use a font family of Garamond or the generic serif font. And we add on a background URL of that particular image. We change the sections up a little bit. We make the navigation, instead of being width of 100%, we make it a width of 30%. We float it to the left. We make the LIs have a display of block so that they don't go horizontal, but they're oriented vertically. We make the sections float and have a width of 30%. We make the links have a color of white. And we make the image have a display of inline with a width of 100%. So this style sheet overrules the first style sheet. How do we know it overrules it? Because it's the second style sheet. The first style sheet gets applied, and then, in some cases, that second style sheet gets applied. And when it applies that second style sheet, it overrules some of the attributes. We don't have to overrule all of them. For example, notice that in our base style sheet, we got rid of the bullet points here. All right. Well, we didn't say anything about the bullet points in the second style sheet. And yet, the bullets in the second style sheet are still gone. Why is that? Well, because if we don't overrule it, then whatever we define in the first style sheet still applies. So, this particular technique is known as progressive enhancement. Because we could actually get more involved than this, right? We could actually create several different style sheets and have a style sheet for a flip phone based on writing a proper media query, a style sheet for a low-end smartphone, a style sheet for a high-end smartphone, a style sheet for a tablet, and then finally a style sheet for a desktop or laptop. So we could take this as far as we wanted to with this. And simply by writing the proper media query, we could make the styles more and more complex and add more stuff the higher end the person's device was. So that's called progressive enhancement. As a person has a higher end or a more elaborate device, we add stuff, we enhance the page. All right, and that's generally the approach that you want to take if you're creating a web page from scratch. You define sort of the bare bones look first to say, hey, look, if someone has a flip phone or someone has a low-end cell phone, this is what it's or a low-end smartphone, this is what it's going to look like. And then you add things in for the more more powerful devices. All right. So that's known as progressive enhancement. So like in this case, we defined a one column layout by making all these sections have a width of 100%. We got rid of the background image. We didn't get rid of the background image. We defined no background image. We made sure all the images within sections were invisible. We then enhanced that for a desktop device by saying, okay, if you're on a desktop device, then use this as a background image. Make the images visible and make their width 100% and so on. So you, with progressive enhancement, which is generally the approach that you're going to take if you're doing a website from scratch, is that you define the bare bones, this is how I want it to look on a mobile device, and then you go and add stuff to it and change stuff for how you want it to look like on a desktop or laptop or a bigger screen. So as you progress, you're adding stuff in. All right. Generally, you're making it more involved. Multiple columns, more images, background images, that sort of thing. And what distinguishes what gets a particular style sheet is what's called the media query. So this is what ensures that this second style sheet only applies when we want it to. Because we don't want that second style sheet to apply all the time. We only want the style sheet to apply under these conditions. If it's a computer screen and the minimum width is 601 pixels actually. Questions? That's the approach you take if you're building a website from scratch. The opposite approach can be taken if you have already a completed website and you want to sort of retrofit it to work on a mobile platform. You know, there's a lot of places that developed their websites before mobile devices were popular. So you could be working on a project where company already has their website. It works fine. They're not necessarily today ready to redesign it. But they do want it to look better on a mobile device. All right? And the technique used to do that is called graceful degradation. So you both end up with the same goal, or at the same ending point. With progressive enhancement, you start with a simple version of the site or mobile, and you add stuff to get a more complex site for a desktop. This approach is also sometimes called mobile first. And again, it's generally the approach that you would want to take if you were starting from scratch. It's a good approach to take because, again, it forces you to think, like, what do people really need when they visit my site on a mobile device? But again, if you already had a completed website and you weren't going to redesign it, you use what's called graceful degradation. And graceful degradation is where you start out with a complex site or a desktop, and then you take away stuff to end up with a simpler version of the site for mobile. This would generally be used if you already had a website and you wanted to make it more mobile compatible. In both cases, how do you accomplish this? You add a second style sheet with a media query. And that either adds or takes away the stuff. And the media query sort of is the opposite. In the case of progressive enhancement, the media query adds that second style sheet if you're on a desktop device. In the case of graceful degradation, we're going to add the second style sheet if we're on a mobile device. So it's like we're ending up at the same goal, hopefully. We're ending up with the same result. A site that works both in a desktop environment that's more complex and a device that is, or a version of it that's simpler for a mobile device. It just matters if you start with everything and take stuff away, or start with the bare bones and then add stuff. It'd be like the difference, the analogy I heard, and this is kind of a goofy analogy, but bear with me, is if you started off and you wanted to make chocolate-covered peanuts, and you wanted to provide for your guests two snacks, chocolate-covered peanuts and then just plain peanuts. You could get that two different ways, right? You could start off with peanuts, and then you could take some of them peanuts and cover them with chocolate. Then you'd have both. You'd have some of them that were still plain peanuts and some of them that were chocolate-covered peanuts. What's the other way that you could do that? Well, the other way is you could start off with getting a big, giant bag of chocolate-covered peanuts and then chip away or melt away the chocolate, and then you'd end up with some peanuts. And then you'd have some chocolate-covered peanuts and peanuts. So, you can either start with simpler and add stuff to it, or you can start with more involved and take stuff away. Now, here's the interesting thing about that analogy. Which sounds like the better approach? The first, right? Why does that sound like a better approach? It's always easier to add than take away. And let's imagine that you're sitting here with a little tiny hammer and chisel and you were chiseling away the chocolate off of that. What's liable to happen? Well, you might leave a little bit of chocolate on or whatever. And it's sort of the same with web development. If you start with something complex and try to take it away, you might end up with some remnants and some stuff left over that you don't really want. But you got to play with the cards that you were dealt, all right? And if you're in a situation where you have a completed website and they're not going to redesign that website for a while, well, then you have to use graceful degradation and you have to go and create a second version of it that takes away stuff from the main version. Let's take a look at the graceful degradation version of this example. And we should notice that it's going to end up being the same, or at least close to the same. There might be some tiny variations. Okay, we look at this within, all right, I didn't make it exactly the same. All right, but here is the desktop version. And let's view the same thing in Google Chrome. And I'll go in might have to tweak this a little bit. Not getting exactly the results I want, but I can still demonstrate. That might be the problem. I think it's here as well. I'll double check. I might have some sort of typo in, but I'm not sure exactly what that is. This doesn't seem to be working. Let's. Yeah, there's media handheld. Ah. Okay. Anyhow, I'm not really sure why this isn't working, but that's okay because this is generally not the approach that you want to take anyhow. But just to demonstrate this, if we look at this, we have a different media query, and this is the base that always applies, and then we have a different mobile style sheet to take away stuff. So, in this case, here's the one style sheet. Well, I have the more involved style sheet, and then in the mobile, actually, this example is very different than the other one. I think that's my mistake, because it is different. Maybe. I was expecting there to be a greater difference. Yeah. See, the only difference in this case is I got rid of the image. I was thinking this was exactly like the other example where it's not. So, yeah, my code was correct initially. I just wasn't expecting it. So, again, what's the difference here? And the difference here, I overrule this rule, and I get rid of the image by saying display of none. So, again, the idea is the same in both cases, that I have two style sheets. One of them is the one that everyone gets by default, and then the second one is only applied under certain conditions. And it can be applied if the device is mobile, or it can be applied if the device is not mobile. And then you either add stuff or take stuff away so that you end up with a page that works under both conditions. So that is responsive web design in a nutshell. This will allow you to create sites that work reasonably well on a desktop and on a mobile platform. Now again, there are other tricks of the trade. This is like chapter one or chapter one and two of mobile web development. There's a lot of things that you can do that require server-side scripting and client-side scripting that can look to see what kind of device you have and then customize it. I think I showed some examples like with my insurance agent where you can actually make a link that will dial your phone. So you can write pages that are smart enough to know you're on a mobile phone, you're not on a desktop browser, and therefore make the link actually physically dial your phone. So there's things you can do along those lines. But those things require scripting, and we don't really talk much about scripting in this class. So at this point, I'm going to put in a shameless plug for CISS 268, which is mobile web design, where we take what we've covered before and go much beyond it. Any questions about this? There's one topic that I think I have skimped on, I'd like to talk about it now, and that is selectors in CSS. All right? This actually sort of reminded me, although I was planning on talking about it anyhow. A pound sign. Notice how that looks different. Pound sign part one, image, display none. What does a pound sign represent? I don't blame you if you don't know it, but we have seen a pound sign before when we created links. Represents an ID, right? So let's go and make a basic HTML page. So far, when we've done our selectors in HTML, selectors in CSS, we've used HTML tags mainly as our selector, probably exclusively. So, I'm going to go in and do something like we've done before. And I'm going to put the style right here. Again, this is a case where do as I say, not as I do. I'm doing it just so that it's easier when I teach to have both the style code and the HTML visible at the same time. So I'm going to include the style code right as part of the HTML. So if I put in a style, and I say H1, background, yellow, color, blue. make a paragraph instead. So I'm going to put a paragraph in the header, and I'm going to put a paragraph in a section, or in an article. So let me save this. Are those two paragraphs going to look the same? No, we're not going to be able to see them at all. Why? Because why? I forgot my in style tag. That's sort of a hint. If you don't see a page at all, you probably forgot to close a tag. All right. Those two look the same. Why do they look the same? Well, because my selector says paragraph. That means every paragraph on the page is going to look a certain way. All right. Sometimes you want to do that. And again, this doesn't work just with paragraphs, but it could work with headings, it could work with links, it could work with images, it could work with any element. You can use an HTML tag as a selector. All right? What if I only wanted the article's paragraph to look that way? How could I do that? If I only wanted the article's paragraph to be have a yellow background and blue text. How would I change the selector? Not pound article. Just article space P. The reason that I can do that is that article's an HTML tag. So I could say article P, and what that says is any paragraph within an article gets a style rule. So if I did that, then my page looks like this. This paragraph doesn't get the style rule because it's not a paragraph within an article. It's a paragraph within a header. This one does, though, because it's an article within a a paragraph within an article. So if I had a bunch of these paragraphs, in fact, if I had a bunch of articles, every one of those paragraphs within articles would get that style, because that's what my selector says. My selector says any paragraph within an article tag gets that selector. And a lot of times that's good. Right? A lot of times that's good, because one of the keys of design, of good web design, is consistency. All right? Things that mean the same thing ought to look the same way. All right? So things that mean the same thing ought to look the same way. All right? So it's good that all the paragraphs within articles, because all else being the same, each paragraph is assumed to have the same importance, the same sort of meaning. They're all paragraphs within articles. I'm not going to differentiate between one or the other. Let's imagine that this is very important. I'm putting exclamation points after it to say that it's very important. How can I make this look different. Give the P an ID. So I'm going to give it an ID maybe of something like warning. Maybe this is like some kind of warning. You know, like maybe this is a weather channel and this is a warning saying that there might be thunderstorms tonight or something like that. All right. And then what I can do is, now that it has an ID, I can give an ID-based style rule. And I can say maybe font size 1.5 EM. All right. So now let's look at what we get. That one's bigger, so it looks a little different. Now, why is it blue text on a yellow background? All right, this has a ID of warning, and here's my style rule for warning. Doesn't say anything about the color and background, and yet it's blue text on a yellow background. Why is that? Well, this, yeah, go ahead.
It's still an article.
Yeah. It's still an article within a paragraph, so that style rule applies. And it has an ID of warning, so that style rule applies. So it's very similar to what we saw before, where more than one style rule can apply. And when more than one applies, whichever one is more specific to that tag takes precedence. In other words, if I had font size 1.1M or 1.2M here, let's say, all the articles have a size of 1.2M, a background of yellow, and a color of blue, except this one. Because the font size of 1.5M overruled the font size of 1.2M. So again, it's an the same idea applies. If you have two styles that apply to something, one of them's going to overrule the other one. All right. And in this case, the ID is going to overrule the tag. So both the style rule for the paragraph within an article apply, and the style rule for the ID applies. So, since there's no color or background mentioned for the warning ID, it gets the background and color from Article P, style rule. But, however, since I've overruled the font size, then the font size that I use for the warning applies. All right. So, there's another thing that we can use. Now, keep in mind, we can mix and match, right? I could, for example, put an ID on a paragraph. I'm sorry, on an article, and then say every paragraph within that. So maybe this is a special article. So I could say pound sign special P, maybe I make the color red. So that one, again, it's still a paragraph within an article, but it's a paragraph within a special article, and therefore it gets an ID, it gets the rule based on the ID of special. So I can mix and match these just like I can mix and match tag-based style rules. There's one other thing that we can do. that we haven't seen at all before, and that's a class. All right? A class works similar to an ID, but with one difference. I'm going to make a fine print class for the stuff that's not really that important. I'm going to do like they do on, you know, contracts and stuff. I'm going to make it real small. I'm going to make it half the size of normal. So notice I said, instead of saying pound sign something, I said dot something, period something. So the pound sign indicates an ID. The period indicates a class. So pound sign fine print means a class of fine print. I'm sorry, period fine print means a class of fine print. Pound sign special means an ID of special. So now if I go and view this, those are real tiny. Those are the ones you gotta be careful for. What's the difference between a class and an ID other than a pound sign versus a dot? Yes. Yeah. The idea is that a class can apply to several things on a page. All right. So in this case, I had a couple of things that are considered the fine print. So I could make each paragraph, you know, each paragraph that qualifies as the fine print, I can apply that class to it. An ID, however, is used to identify one thing and one thing only. And this will become important as you get into JavaScript. So if you say an ID of something, there should only be one thing on the page that has that ID. It's just like your student ID, right? Whatever your student ID number is, that identifies you. There aren't two people that have that same student number. All right, that would be a mess if it did. Well, it's the sort of same idea here. When you have an ID on something, that should uniquely identify it. I should say, yep, that's the only one that has this property. A class, though, is, you know, just like think of a class of students, you know, sophomores or freshmen. Well, there can be more than one student in that class, or more than one out-of-county student, or whatever. You know, when you talk about class, you're talking about a group of things. So more than one thing can be a class, in a class where only one thing should have an ID. Now, the use of IDs has actually gone down since we've gone to HTML5. In the old days, you used to have a bunch of divs, and you would give them an ID, a div for nav, a div for header, a div for whatever. Now with HTML5, when we have separate tags for those things, there's less of a need for IDs. All right? So generally, most of the time, you're going to be using classes. Because, you know, unless you're really sure that there's only one thing that's going to have a particular characteristic, you know, you'd want to make it a class to allow there to be multiple things that get that style rule. All right, so that's another kind of selector that you can have in addition to the HTML tags that we've covered so far. Any questions about this? Yes?
I actually missed how you assign classes to the different
others. Yeah, it's just an attribute.
Yeah, okay.
Instead of saying ID equals something, you say class equals something. And that way it knows that this paragraph fits that class. Okay, that's all I had today. We'll see you up in lab.